I think you've set the bar really high for me, so I'm just going to try to explain myself. Actually, the title that I sort of set for this was called The Quirky View of WeTick on the Digital Front. But anyway, hopefully I'll sort of give you my perspective. Please feel free to connect to me on any of the social media that you use, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, whatever. It doesn't really matter. I use it just for fun as well as for work. You know, it's a way of communication these days. A lot of my messages these days are on Facebook messengers, even for work. So, you know, just feel free to connect. So, I do have a blog that I actively use, you know, published, adultlearningarch.com. It's related to the book I wrote. I won't really cover that today. There's plenty of material on the website. You can look it up. Mostly on video. So, like today, I put it on video. I'll usually cut the video and it get uploaded into the blog. So let me just start by saying this. The literate of the 21st century said, Alvin Toffler, some 30 plus years ago, will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. I think how true that is. So if we teach our kids about content, about information, I think we are about one or two generations behind. We need to teach our kids how to learn. That really is and ought to be the objective of education. And so when I teach, I teach a class in NUS, School of Information Science, I focus the kids, the students, really on how they can adapt to the fast changing pace of the world today. Be you call it digital or whatever you call it, doesn't really matter. The world is changing so fast that if you don't learn how to learn, you will fall behind. So content, you can always Google. How to learn is a separate matter altogether. Anyway, that's again not the topic, but you know, let me just launch to my view on the world of as I see it. You know, robotics and automation is coming, right? So a lot of us are looking at robotics. As you look at robotics, software robotics that can, as it is today, robotics, software robotics is still pretty much a souped up macro, if you like. But you know, the various iteration of improvement on that technology will get to a stage where it's going to be very scary. A lot of our adults, operations or be it even in IT, will get displaced, right? So let me just give you some of the views. One of the mega trend really is that the world is moving towards a real time and not batch. If you think about Uber, if you have taken Uber here, you get immediately how much you spend, the mapped of the ride, and immediately in the account you can check all the rides previously. But if you were to use your credit cards, you probably don't really know how much you've spent to date for the month until you get your batched report, so to speak, at the end of the month. The banks are trying, so to speak, right? They have an app now that they throw into your phone and they try to give you real-time spend information as you scan your card, they also popped up. This is sort of in a response to some of the real-time versus batch phenomenon we are experiencing as consumer. All of us wants to have real-time, not batch. Think of it, what's in it for the board, what's in it for the C-level, what's in it for the executive and the working level that needs information on a real-time basis. There's repercussion on everything that we do, from the board needing to know what are the key issues that's happening in security, to the CEO that needs to know how much is the profit and loss on a real-time basis. But you know what? We don't have it. Everything is in batch mode. That transition from batch to real-time is ongoing and is one of the key business disruption that's going to hit us. So, you know, credit card versus Uber, that's like a key example why credit card won't be much longer if they don't wake up and go real time, right? Because Uber won't necessarily eat their lunch, but Apple Pay and the rest of the Android payment system will probably, you know, take a cut out of that. Data, not guts. What I mean by this is that it's a fundamental shift in the way businesses are, you know, looking at data and running the business. I have an Instagram account. I know out of the 6,500 followers that I have, how many of them are from the US, from Singapore. I know when is the best time to post, 8 a.m. on the Wednesday morning, apparently, based on the analytics. I know how many likes I get within the window of 60 minutes. I know how many likes I will get from the first hour, eventually how many likes I will end up with that single post. These are all analytics that I get on my Instagram. I'm not saying because of, you know, showing off that I have 6,500 followers. Some of you might have more. The issue is that in our business world today, we don't have half the data we need to run our business. But on Instagram, I have more information I need to understand and manage my Instagram account, Something is not quite right. If our CEO is running a business and is flying blind without data, something is wrong. So I think we really need to wake up to the world of the trends where data is used to drive every single decision. Two generations and a generation ago, most of the leaders, the board members, well, some board members today still, will operate on the basis of guts. We think the business is going to go this way. We decide this is the direction. CEO, please follow, right? But I think without data, that's not going to work. I think we need data to make decisions. And I think this is quite clear, one of the key mega trends that's hitting all the business today. There's another mega trend of democratization of information. I think power used to reside with those that withhold information. So I clearly remember where I had to go to a particular person to ask for the organization structure because that is a secret, right? When org structure changes, the person that holds the org structure information becomes power base or power broker, because in order to know who is doing what, you got to go to this person to figure out what needs to be, how things can be done in the organization. I think the democratization of information is here. We got to figure out how to disseminate that information across the organization, across the industry. And the power is not with the person who holds the information. The power is with the person who knows how to make business decision out of that information. So this is kind of a small trend, but I've seen it still in a lot of organizations that is in transition from the old model to the new that uses information. AI will replace some manual processes. I say some. I think it's probably not true that AI, artificial intelligence, will replace all processes. I think that's a bit too far-fetched. Leon Gerhardt, you can look him up. Leon Gerhardt is one of the futurists, and he talks about those things that can be automated will be automated. Those things that cannot be automated will become valuable. So we need to teach our kids that actually those things that are not going to be automated, like empathy, creativity, compliance, understanding or empathy, relationship with people, that sort of stuff will become really, really valuable, right? Those things that can be automated, well, even engineering and coding, for example, will go away. And I think those eventually will become completely automated. Obviously, some jobs will go, including medicine, right? You think about the recent case where IBM Watson was looking at the data and looking at the diagnostic, all the tests that comes out. And they could, Watson could actually, it's not by any means an advertisement for Watson, but Watson found out that there is this particular disorder that's rare. For a doctor to be able to pick that up on first go is quite hard, right? Because the amount of data that needs to be crunched to come up with that answer is a difficult one. It's just way too much information to be processed, right? So I think some jobs will go, but I think the augmentation of AI to each of us, in other words, we will still have our job, but it will be augmented by AI rather than be replaced. It's going to be with us very, very soon. Well, that's my view from a trend perspective. One more trend that I see is that a lot of times we use process to drive the business, but I think we're coming to a stage where decisions are going to become real time. We need to have data, we need to have contextual data that allows us to make decision on a real-time basis. Oftentimes, we used to think of like data lake that will help us project and almost prophetically think about the future, as if the past history of data can give us some kind of prediction of the future. Unfortunately, past history and past data may not necessarily give us a full view of that. We still need to have some kind of a wisdom applied to the data to think about what are the trends that's coming. So my view is, if you're going to think about how to build a data lake or some kind of a data warehouse, think of it not like a lake where you dump all the data and then you get your analysts to fish for information to make it useful, but think of it like building a beer factory. No, maybe that Friday beer, a beer factory as in, there's inputs, there's output, and the engineers or, that the plant engineers needs to look at specific point. What is the temperature here? What's the pH? What's the amount of mixture between this sort of ingredient? And what is the output that goes out? Those key contextual questions, I like to term it as business contextual questions, are meant to then help you think about what data that you need for that particular point. So if you run But let's say a mortgage department, you want to know what is the flow of incoming account that's being opened, what is the NPL that's being clocking over the, on a real-time basis. These sort of contextual question allows you to design the type of question and data you need for that particular point in the process, like a beer factory, that particular point in the process, what data you need, what decision you need on a real-time basis. Think of it like flying a plane. You have all these, you know, gears and stuff that tells you, and then you use that to basically fly the plane. In some ways, our CEOs and our business leaders don't really have enough of that sort of dashboard, so to speak. They are given very batch process. They give a nice thick document every month on all the dashboards that our EDM or our data warehouse produce. And really, the world is coming to a stage where batch reports are just not going to cut it. It needs to be a dashboard, a real-time maneuvering of the business context. So we need instruments, we need instrumentation, we don't need reports. So we need to think about our business questions and context and how they can essentially drive the business forward and what instruments we need to give them to drive the business. If you think about the CEO, if you put a CEO on a plane and you know, here, go fly the plane, unless he or she is a trained pilot, probably that won't, you know, it won't happen. It won't happen overnight at least. Maybe a few weeks of training perhaps. But if you look at our business, they look at this cockpit and they go like, it's just too complicated. I can't do this, right? There's this company that built a particular brand of a plane called Icon A5. I was looking at getting a license to fly and I checked this out and it was really, really sleek. Go check out if you have the same desire to learn how to fly. This is how the cockpit looks like, right? Simplicity. There's only three dashboards, right? And that's it, right? And they boil it down to the essence of flying. Basically, if you master the two or three dashboards, you don't crash the plane. And you can learn to fly this in 2 weeks, 10 days, literally. That's how our business needs to be designed. We need to rethink how we provide instrumentation to our business leaders, not the data warehouses and whatever we have built with stacks of reports, you know, because we are so cool, we can give all kinds of permutation, but it's not really useful to drive the business. That's the wrong way of looking at it. We need to design for human beings. We need to design the dashboards and design everything in simplicity, in simple terms, so that we can drive the business forward. That's the mega trend. So design thinking, usability, UI, UX, all those things comes to play. We talk about it, but the question I think ultimately lies in the system architecture of what we built. It's not going to be the little pieces of, you know, code for SQL or databases or stuff like that, but it's how we put all those together and how we allow our business leaders to drive the business forward on a real-time basis, maneuvering the terrain, maneuvering the weather that's changing always, right? And the regulatory landscape that's forever, you know, become more complex and harder. So the literate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write. If I translate this to the IT world, it's not going to be those who can code and design application. It's going to be those who can learn, relearn, unlearn how to architect this thing for businesses to fly the business, so to speak, right? Kind of making it a little bit stretch, but you get what I'm trying to say. Peter Drucker said this: we now accept the fact that learning is the lifelong process of keeping abreast of change, and the most pressing task is to teach people how to learn. Cannot emphasize this. I mean, as a CEO, I emphasize this with my 300 people in my team. I said, look, you guys will be changing. I can tell you, I change the organizing structure every week just for fun. No, not quite for fun. I tinker with it because the world is changing, and if I don't change to respond, it's going to be hard to win in the market out there. I need all of you on board, and I need all of you to take responsibility and accountability for your own learning. And you're not just running an action, you're accountable for something. So I ask, what are you accountable for, and what change do you need in order to succeed? Big question. I give you some examples from what I've seen in the past world. Nifty Form, I used to work for PwC for a couple of years, slightly more than a couple of years, no regrets. You know, in Australia, they have this tax consulting that's very lucrative. They basically go around and do all these tax claims on innovation, R&D, that they come to, you know, tax consulting in PwC. So one day, the digital team, which was technology, and the tax team came together for brainstorming, and they came with this great idea. You know, all these smaller mom and pop, 10, 15 million type company, they cannot afford the tax consultants of PwC, right? 50K, 100K a pop to get the R&D. If they can get the claims back at equivalent of 50, 100K, that saving is gone, so don't bother. So what they did was they did a self-service McDonald's-style R&D claims. They set up a form called Nifty Forms, and you could put all your information into the form, company and all the claims and stuff like that. So the tax consultant doesn't really get involved. It's until you fill up everything. And at the end, you could basically self-service your R&D claim. The tax consultant at the back will then work on the case, and assuming a young tax manager look at it and say, okay, hammer out the case on a weekend, they get extra bonus and extra pay at the end of the month or year. The tax partner happy because they can serve extra segment of the customer which they never had before, so new revenue stream. And of course, the smaller companies can use this tax. Happy, 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 win, win, win. According to the Sand Habits, very good. But here's the problem. The big boys, the P&G and the Unilevers that used to use tax consulting from PwC said, hey, hang on, why am I paying you 50K? Can I use this? I can pay you 5K and I get the same thing done, right? So when a few of these questions came in, the tax partners basically had some bubble punctured in their head. You know, their Ferrari started to disappear. And they were wondering, okay, do we continue with this business? Because, you know, all our tax clients is going to say, give me this, as opposed to why do I have to pay a big, you know, expensive tax consultant? Or do we continue with this and open it up so that we can then take the lunch of Deloitte, EY, and KPMG? Glad to say they continue with it, but I don't think it's an easy one because the debate is about disappearing revenue from SMS and, you know, WhatsApp that doesn't really quite give you the same set of revenue. Singtel would attest to that. It's a declining and yet. So that's a balance of business going and business coming. And you know what? This is the digital world we're in. This is the mega train we're in. We really need to think about how to sustain the business by flipping over to the new world with new mega trends and new changes without necessarily figuring a way to, having a proper answer to how we are not cannibalizing our old businesses. Unfortunately, that's the reality. So as a business leader, you have to deal with that, right? So I'm giving an example which I faced, my colleague in PwC faced. I give you an example, and then I'll probably stop, and then maybe we'll look at questions you have. The Shai Agassi, big SAP person, and was slated to be the CEO, but didn't get it, so he quit. He went to Israel, and he started a business. The business eventually failed, but the story was very interesting. He asked the question, why is electric cars not really happening? It should be easy, right? It's green, it's good, it's cheaper, you know, but yet nobody's really buying, right? So why can't we sell electric car like we sell, say, handphone? Today, mobile phone, and it comes with a plan. You buy a phone, it's cheaper than the cost, right? Most of us get our phone for cheaper, it's subsidized by Singtel or StarHub on the basis of a 2-year contract or whatever contracts that you sign up, right? The more bundled packages you sign up, the better the rate you pay for the phone, or cheaper, so to speak, when you pick up the handset. So why can't we sell electric cars like we sell handphone? We package the whole car. One of the issues is battery and battery lives. You drive into the battery replacement center, basically the Shell and whatever, and you get your new battery and you drive away and it's fully charged and it's 2 minutes replacement. You get your drinks, whatever, along the way and you pay and you go. Why can't the Shell or the electric car owns the battery, gets all the sort of, in the whole thing is owned by the whole same company, right? So in essence, you don't really care whether it's an old battery or new battery, it's all owned by the same company and it's operating on a very different business model. You buy the car cheap and then you sign up for 10 years and you pay over 10 years time, right? The business model seems to make sense. Unfortunately, it didn't work. It was way too ahead of the time. I think the time is here. A lot of the business models are getting disrupted, but unfortunately, we are still thinking technology. We're still thinking technology, cloud technology. Not wrong, they are right, things that we need to think about, but if you stop thinking about business model change, you are only baking it halfway. It's not going to work. You got to rethink the business model. You got to rethink the engagement with the board. You got to rethink the way it's funded. You got to rethink the experience, how the experience of the consumer or your customer is looking at it from a holistic end-to-end, and remodel completely and be aggressive enough to want to change it. perspective. I mean, I'm citing this as an example. It was a failed example, but I think it's time, because some of these could be too early. A lot of the business model are ripe for disruption, right? So I don't have time to show this video, but I have it here. The deck, if it's sent out, you can click on it. It's Leon Gerhardt talking about what the world looks like in the next, you know, 5-10 years and so on, right? So look up Leon Gerhardt and his video. That's it. I kind of give you lots of stuff to think about. Actually, I do best if there are questions so that we can interact a little bit, but I'm not sure. Very quiet bunch today after lunch, so I'm not sure. Do I have time for questions if there's any?
2 to 3 minutes.
2 to 3 minutes, right. So I'll take some questions if there's any brave souls who want to venture. Please, anything goes. Love, life, death, whatever. Yes. Yes, sir. Yeah, thank you. I certainly, in my class, I'm teaching how to learn. But I think if you think disruption is hitting the business hard, and it's certainly hitting the university very, very hard, because the universities tend to change the syllabus every 10, 20 years. You know, it's almost in a decade's term. It's good to know that some universities are trying really, really hard, because, see, part of the thing is that we don't really sense enough. So, you know, the one of the things that you think about is the OODA loop, O-O-D-A, right? It's a military term where you sense and then you try to adjust your strategy and then you go back and then you change your tactic and then you sense again and so on, right? That sensing and coming back and changing, and we don't do it enough in business. So university is the same. They don't do it enough. So, but glad to say that there's a bit more of it. So, you know, some of the universities are beginning to get more involvement with people from the industry to be involved in the curriculum design, right? So I sat in the NUS Infocom, along with a few industry to talk about what really should be in the curriculum, right? What will people like myself want to hire, want to see in the kids that comes out from the university? So there's a bit more of that, right? But not enough. I think we are still a long way from being where it should be. It's my view. We're still teaching content. We're still teaching contents that could be learned from Coursera, could be learned from, you know, Khan Academy, you know, in their spare time, so to speak, right? These, you know, the courses on coding and all that, I think really should be given away. One of the complaints that I have is that we don't teach enough system architect. We don't teach enough of big picture design. We teach very macro and micro views of how to do technology, which I think is good and is necessary for foundation. But eventually, to build very, very nice sort of picture of the new world, we need architects. The reason is because if you think about this building, we've been building, human beings have been building buildings like this since the time of pyramids. So 6,000 years of experience. We have architects, engineers, structural engineers, civil engineers, bricklayers, supervisors, and go on, right? Some are even regulated, and it's actually things that we know what the role means when we say it. If I ask you, what is the definition of a data scientist in an Infocom world? I think for everyone you ask, you get a different view. Is it an Excel cruncher? Is it a data pattern researcher? Is it a... We don't have a definition of what IT is. You know why? Because we have only built application for the last 60 years, 60. 60 and 6,000, that's two magnitude of zeros. That's a huge difference in the maturity of building a building and building an application. And I think in the last 5-10 years, we have actually surpassed the complexity of building application when it comes to the complexity of a building. We know exactly how high we can build. We know what kind of earthquake it will withstand based on all the material engineering that we have. We have no idea what complexity of application is today. 60 years. I mean, you know, it's an excuse, but yeah, it's an excuse for ourselves, right? But still, it is the truth. We don't have long enough to know how to set up all the structure we need to build complex application. That's why the banks, the telcos, everybody is having complex IT environment. It's very complex because we don't have a system architect that know how to, not a person, but the functions is not mature enough. So I hope that answered your question, but I went long about way. So any other question? One more? Last one, please. No, if not, I will thank you very much for your patience and your attention. Thanks.